Hi, I'm Tyler Furkis from the University of Wisconsin Stevens Point Northern Aquaculture Demonstration Facility. And today we're going to talk about recirculating aquaculture systems. Recirculating aquaculture systems, or RAS, have a lot of different complex components. And it's really important to understand all of the different aspects of RAS systems and what goes into them, so that you know what you're working with or what you need to construct if you're considering recirculating aquaculture. In this system, we're raising Atlantic salmon, which is a great species for recirculating aquaculture systems. These fish are slightly over 2 years old and are about at the market size you would expect to see Atlantic salmon at in a RAS system. And as I mentioned, they're a great species for RAS aquaculture. RAS systems can be very expensive to design and operate, so it's really important to select a species that's going to be successful in this type of system. Atlantic salmon are a great species to raise in RAS aquaculture because they're a high dollar market value species. They have really well-established protocols for raising them, and they're very well known. A lot of people are seeking out Atlantic salmon for food fish. Atlantic salmon also reach market size relatively quickly, only requiring 2 years of culture. Egg availability is another really important consideration, and Atlantic salmon are one of the species that have year-round availability of eggs. The first stage of a RAS system is where your fish are. These fish are getting consistent feed supply, and some of that feed goes uneaten, and some of the feed that is eaten is defecated out into the tanks. That feed, because of the circular design of these tanks, that feed and waste will go into the bottom drain of this tank setup. And these tanks are set up as a dual drain system. So a portion of the flow will go out that bottom drain into a standpipe, where we can pull that standpipe and remove any solids at the bottom of that cup drain. And a portion of the flow will go out of a side box there and go back to our drum filter. So the standpipe in these tanks sets the height of the water within the tank. And you can adjust the height of this so that you can have different water heights and different flow rates in your systems. As I mentioned, the standpipe in these tanks is connected to that bottom drain. And when you want to clean out that bottom drain from the solids that collect there, you can pull this standpipe, direct the water flow out of the tank, and often we'll plunge these standpipes to pull any solids out from the bottom. As mentioned earlier, not all of the flow will go down that bottom drain. A portion will be going up the side box here, as you can see in this picture, and this goes right to our drum filter for solids removal. The great thing about the design of dual drain tanks is that while you can remove solids out of the one side, having a separate drain allows you to have more fine control over the volume of water flowing through the tank, and it can allow you to have the exchange rates within the tank that you desire. Oftentimes, we're shooting for a replacement rate of 2, so 2 full tank replacements per hour in these tanks. One of the most important aspects of a recirculating system is solids removal. And one great way of removing solids is using drum filtration. These drum filters are designed so that any of the water coming out of these tanks will pass over the screen of this drum filter and over a fine mesh that's on the outside of it. And as that water passes through, any solids larger than the mesh size will collect on that screen. When the screen collects enough of those solids where the screen will get plugged up and the flow is slower, this will automatically spray those solids into a effluent stream, and that will remove those from the system so that they don't build up and become harmful for the fish. After coming out of the drum filter, water will go into the sump, and this is the low point of the recirculating aquaculture system. here's where all of the water will be collecting. You can see that we have some makeup water here, which makes up the 5% of the water that is not reused. You'll always want some of your water to be overflowing out of the system. And this is also part of the 5% or up to 5% of water that is not reused within the system. Makeup water and any water sprayed out from the drum filter will be exiting your system so that it's not building up for the fish, and will go out of these troughs into our settling basin and artificial wetland before being discharged into the receiving water. So after going into the sump, our system is designed that will pump water out of the sump and up into our biofilter. And biofilters are really important. In this system, we have a sand biofilter. So this is filled up to about here with sand. And that sand is simply acting as a substrate for bacteria to grow on. That bacteria has a really important job in a RAS system. It's converting ammonia and nitrite, the harmful forms of nitrogen in our system, into nitrate, the less harmful forms for the fish. So this sand in these systems is really important for culturing that bacteria, and we're trying to get as much surface area on that sand in contact with the water so that the bacteria can do its job effectively. In RAS systems, you'll want to make sure that you have enough sand in the system, and periodically you'll have to replace this sand as through shearing forces, the sand particle size will get smaller and be pushed out of the system. After going through the biofilter, the water will be pushed up to the top of this tower into our degassing column. So here water will enter the top of this column and ultimately fall through a lattice designed to agitate that water and push any buildup of CO2 and other gases that we don't want out of that water, out of suspension of the water. At the same time, there's a low head oxygenator at the bottom of this column where we're able to add oxygen back in to have suitable oxygen levels for the fish. Following degassing and reoxygenation, our water will get pumped through chilling units so that we can maintain it at the water temperature desired. So for example, when we have Atlantic salmon in here, we want to keep that water temperature at about 13 to 14 degrees Celsius. The last stage of our RAS system is UV filtration. So we have UV lamps that will remove any harmful pathogens or parasites that might be in our water. So it's a really important step for making sure your water is clean for your fish. After going through all of these steps, we've now removed solids with our drum filter, removed any excess buildup of ammonia and nitrite. We've removed any dissolved gases that are undesirable. We've added oxygen back into the system and disinfected with UV. And at this point, our water is now clean and suitable to be pumped back to our fish tanks with our distribution pumps. It's important in any system to have backups. So in our case, we have two separate distribution pumps so that if one goes down, we can have another online immediately so that we can swap out the pump that happens to go out. So having replication in all aspects of a RAS system is very important. And being able to respond to issues like that is really critical to maintaining your RAS and making sure that your fish stay happy and healthy. Because of the complexities of RAS systems, it's really important to have monitoring systems in place so that if any of your water quality parameters are out of your set parameters, you can respond and find a solution rapidly. In our case, we're monitoring dissolved oxygen, water temperature, and oxygen saturation continuously in our systems. We also have flow meters on our circulation pumps and water level meters in our sumps, so that if anything goes wrong or water stops flowing, we can be alerted immediately and address that issue as soon as it comes up. Our low head oxygenator is run using liquid oxygen, and we have a bulk oxygen tank that supplies that oxygen. We'll generally monitor our flow rates and make sure they're adjusted so that the oxygen content and concentration in our tanks is optimal for the fish growth. In our systems, we utilize belt feeders to provide a consistent supply of feed to our Atlantic salmon. It's often important that you use the feeds specifically designed for recirculating systems because it's critical that the pellet stays together and doesn't break up rapidly inside these systems, as that can clog up your drum filter pretty quickly. In comparison, this is our warm water recirculating system. Right now we're raising walleye, but in these two systems we've raised over 10 different species over the last 15 years or so. So there's a lot of potential different components that you can add to these systems, and not all recirculating systems are made the same. This system is maintained at approximately 20 degrees Celsius while we're growing walleye out. There are a lot of different ways you can design a recirculating aquaculture system. So for example, on our warm water system, in addition to a drum filter, we have a radial flow separator that removes solids by slowing down the water flow and allowing those solids to separate out to the bottom. And periodically, we'll drain that flow so that solids can be removed out of the system. And this is just an additional step to remove solids before they're removed by the drum filter. There are also different methods for adding oxygen to a recirculating system. I mentioned low head oxygenators, but this system is equipped with a spice cone or oxygen cone, which is another way of efficiently delivering oxygen to your water. Spice cones operate by injecting oxygen under pressure. And as that pressure drops while the water goes to the bottom of the cone, that oxygen dissolves efficiently into the water column. So these are just two examples of recirculating aquaculture systems that we have here. It's really important if you're considering running your own recirculating system that you have a good design in mind, you work with somebody who can engineer this system for you, and you know what you're getting into before you start. There's a lot of different components to these systems, and they can be expensive to run and build. We can serve as a good resource if you have any questions about starting or running a recirculating aquaculture system. You can reach us at aquaculture.uwsp.edu.